Well, the Thessalonians, they have a Bible. And in this scripture, Paul is answering the questions that they have about the return of Christ. And will those who died before Christ's return be resurrected? They were worried about that. You can imagine if you had loved ones and you were having a debate in church. Well, you know, if they died before Jesus came back, would they still be resurrected? Paul says yes, and they'll be resurrected before the living. You can stop worrying. He didn't quite put it like that. That's basically what he's telling them. Stop worrying. Your loved ones will be resurrected. You see, they weren't afraid of the end times as we call it. They were looking forward to Christ's return, not in fear of it as modern Christians are today. Kind of funny, 3 years people ask me, they're like, Pastor Bob, are you afraid of the end times? I look at them and I go, no, I'm a Christian. Christians aren't afraid of the end times. We look forward to it. I mean, why would you dread the return of Christ? Why would you live in fear that Christ is going to return? But I also tell them, I said, I don't really think a whole lot about the end time because I might not make it to the end time. I might die before it happens, and I got to be ready now. I could give this sermon and have a heart attack and die right in front of you all. I got to be ready now. I can't wait till the end time. I got to be ready now. And if it doesn't come in my lifetime, I still got to be ready. I believe in the end time, but not like you've been taught by the entertainment industry to believe. Which brings us to the book of Revelation. If what you have heard about the book of Revelation makes you want to avoid the book of Revelation, then what you have heard isn't from God. If something makes you avoid the Word of God, it isn't from God. Did you know there's 404 verses in Revelation and 278 of them are basically from the Old Testament? So if you're terrified of Revelation, start reading the Old Testament. Revelation is what's called apocalyptic literature. It's not the only writing of its kind. The Jewish people before and during the time of Jesus loved to write apocalyptic literature. It has a basic format. The symbols used in it, everybody understood it because they grew up with it. It's sort of like the murder mysteries and the Harlequin romances. You know, you all know what's going to happen, and they had these apocalyptic literature. They read it all the time. They wrote it all the time. They just happened to pick Revelation to be the one they put in the Bible. By the way, the word Revelation and Apocalypse are basically the same thing. And apocalyptic literature always describes times of persecution. It's always written during times of persecution to give persecuted people hope. Revelation is a book of hope for persecuted people. If it doesn't give you hope, you've been listening to the entertainment industry, including the false teachers and preachers. You don't understand it because you aren't an ancient Jew raised with this type of symbolic writing, and you aren't really persecuted in the country, no matter what you tell each other. Go to Africa, Asia, South America, where thousands of Christians are being murdered for being Christian. That's a persecution. We're just inconvenienced. If you want to know what Revelation says, go to Revelation chapter 14, verses 19-13, and it's basically the cliff notes. It tells you that you're going to be persecuted, and that if you betray God and join the persecutors, or you listen to the false teachers, you will be punished with them forever. If you follow them, you'll be punished. And then it goes on to say, basically, that if you are faithful to God during the time of persecution and don't listen to the false teachings, you'll be with God. I mean, that's a horrifying thing, isn't it? I mean, that's scary stuff. If you listen to the false teachers and follow the persecutors, you're going to be punished. And if you follow God, you're going to be with God. It's that simple. It also says it's supposed to happen soon. Apocalyptic literature is always hidden until its time of fulfillment. So the book of Daniel, written in the 500s, did not appear until 164 AD, around that time period when the Jewish people were being persecuted. So it's always hidden away until the time that it applies to. Apocalyptic literature always appears during the time of persecution that it's meant for. The book of Revelation was written and appeared during the persecution of the Emperor Domitian. It says it'll last 3.5 years, the persecution. Guess what? It lasted 3.5 years. At the end of 3.5 years, the head of his bodyguard and his wife stabbed him to death. And the persecution ended. Throughout the book of Revelation, it says this is going to take place soon. Revelation chapter 1, the first verse. Chapter 2, verse 25, chapter 3, verse 11, chapter 22, verse 6 and 7, 8 and 12 and 20. Revelation 22:10 says, "And he said to me, do not seal up the words of the prophecy of this book, for the time is near." He said to the one who was writing this down, John, that do not hide this book, because the time is here. It applies to now. But see, prophecy lives on for each generation that is persecuted. So it still has meaning today for those who are persecuted to give them hope. TV, movies, and books talk about the horrors of the end time. Well, they don't actually tell it like the book of Revelation tells it. You aren't at the final battle between God and Satan. You don't form an army of God. God takes care of Satan without your help. It isn't even a battle. Satan is close to being God's equal, despite what the entertainment industry portrays. Armageddon isn't the final battle in Revelation, by the way. There's two more after it. Armageddon takes place in chapter 16 against the kings. That means the unbelievers and their armies. Chapter 19 is another battle against the beast and their armies. Chapter 20 is a battle with Satan and his army. And you aren't involved in any of them, so don't worry about having your Uzi or your sword or spear or whatever it is that you've been told you're going to need. The God who created the entire universe, including Satan, doesn't need help putting down one of his creations. If he wanted to, he could go, poof, you're gone. The Antichrist, by the way, doesn't appear in the book of Revelation, despite everything you've been told. The Antichrist is in the letters of John. It's not an all-powerful part of God. Actually, there's many Antichrists, and it's usually people trying to lead Christians from Christ. Ooh, the terror. You don't get raptured out of the way of the bounds of Revelation. The word rapture doesn't appear anywhere in the Bible. An Anglican priest called Darby, back in the 1800s, I believe it was, decided that God would save the world through the Jewish people, and he had to get the Christians out of the way for that to happen, so he got the Christians out of the way by what he called the rapture. Darby came today at Dallas Theological Seminary, Schofield Bible, the late great Planet Earth book, the Left Behind series, and some of the writings of Bethel. Most of her stuff is good, except if she talks about Daniel or Revelation. A large part of the book of Revelation is describing a persecution of Christians. It starts off with seven letters that say, you're going to be persecuted. There's going to be false teachers. If you follow them, you will burn with them. And if you're faithful to God, you'll be saved. And the rest of the book is the playing out of the seven letters. But we never talk about the seven letters because there's not all that gore and all that other stuff in it. Four seals are opened and the four horsemen of the apocalypse are released, unleashing the persecution of Christians, which don't show harm to other people, because evil attacks everybody. How do we know this is a persecution? The fifth seal is open, and the martyrs in heaven are shown asking God, how long will he allow this persecution of the church to continue? Eventually, the persecutors get punished in the sixth seal. They follow cycles of persecution, of false teachings, and God's punishment until eventually Satan is thrown into the lake of fire to burn forever. By the way, despite what we've been told, he doesn't rule there. He's burning right alongside him. After all of that, after it's completed, then we are raised up to the clouds. I'll talk about that in a couple of minutes. It doesn't say heaven, it says clouds. It's not a revelation, it's not a secret code. Numbers are symbolic. You've all heard the dreaded 666. Did you know that in the oldest manuscripts of the Revelation, that some of them say 616, and some of them say 666? They had a game that they used to play with numbers. The letters would have a value. And you will find graffiti on walls in which they wrote, I love the one whose number is. Then take your name, and that will give you your number. Now, Nero was also known as Neron, depending on which part of the empire you were in. If it was Nero, it was 616 was his number. If it was Neron, it was 666. It says it's a human number. And the early Christians believed that if you were the first great one on something, you get credit for it forever. So any persecutions after that, Nero gets credit. The numbers 3, 4, and 7, 10 and 12 are symbolic numbers. We have this raging debate, pre-millennial, post-millennial, amillennial. Well, 1,000 is 10 to the third power. It's the total, complete spiritual reign of Christ, because they believe that there would be times in which you worship God like you were supposed to. Then you drifted away, releasing Satan into the world until things got so bad you yelled to God for help. He saved you, you worshiped him again the way you were supposed to. But people go around like, how did Satan go away today? You turned them loose by drifting away from God, releasing sin into the world. People have this raging argument. Only 144,000 people are going to be saved. Guess what? You're all out of luck, because we've had, I don't know how many billion Christians since Christ died. I'm sure 144,000 of them are going to heaven. Well, I don't know what you're doing here. But if you don't believe that, you realize that 144,000 is a multiple of 12, it's a multiple of 10, and that says all the people of God will be going to heaven. It says Jewish tribes, because early Christians were considered Jews, who just believed that the Messiah had come, as opposed to Jews who were still waiting for him. It seems like most Christians have been led to dread the return of Christ by the entertainment industry. Like early Christians, I look forward to it probably because I know where I'm going. Do you? If you do, what are you worried about? Paul in 1 Thessalonians is answering questions that people had back then, and probably some do today. He says, I do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, except you may not be as others do who have no hope. Pagans had no hope. They were the majority of people at that time. Christians were worried about their loved ones. Paul says, don't worry about your Christian loved ones. They're fine. He says, for since we believe that Christ died and rose again, even so through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. So don't worry about your deceased loved ones. They're going to heaven just like you are. He says, for this we declare to you by the word of the Lord that we who are alive are left, who are left until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who have died. So he's basically saying they're going to be actually be resurrected before you are. And then he says, then we who are alive who are left will be caught up in the clouds together with them to be years, and we will live with the Lord forever. After the previously dead are raised, the living will be raised, and we'll all meet each other up in the clouds. It didn't say heaven. Revelation or 1 Thessalonians, well, it's the same thing. They think we'll go up to the clouds. You notice you always see heaven in the movies as this cloudy place. Why are we going up to the clouds and not all the way to heaven? God is destroying and remaking both heaven and earth. You're going up into the clouds, not heaven, because heaven and earth are going away to be replaced by new heaven and earth. Your new home is being renovated. Or if you watch TV nowadays, it's being flipped. Revelation 21, verses 1 through 4. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. Why do I believe in the end time? First, I don't think of it as an end time. I really believe in it as a beginning time. A time of universe transformation, actually universe transfiguration. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, adorned for her husband. Sorry, you don't go up to heaven. A part of heaven's coming to earth to be our resurrection dwelling place with God. And why do all preachers say that? Our loved ones are in heaven. We're lying to you. But we're going to be in heaven, but it's coming to us. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, see, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. We will be together with God, because our relationship with God will now be right. We'll become the people he created us to be. There's not going to be a church building because we are directly with God. Death will be no more, mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away. Wow, this is terrifying. I really want to avoid Jesus coming back and doing this kind of stuff to us. This scripture tells us of a new beginning where we are free of the suffering of our present physical life and bodies. Everything has to end. These physical bodies that we inhabit will end. Everything we have built will end. All the churches in the world that we built will end. The caterpillar universe will become a butterfly universe. And if you believe that God created the universe, then you don't have a problem with God having the power to transform it. What will be left? The relationship you've built with God. Also, in some way, the relationships you've built with other people, but you don't get to bring your old limited love, your cliques, your disputes, your prejudices with you. If you really don't want to be with those people, you might be told at the pearly gates, I'm sorry, they're inside here. Everything that is being fought about in the news will not be tolerated in heaven. We will be transferred into the all-inclusive, loving people that God created us to be. And on the day of resurrection, we'll be transfigured into perfect spiritual bodies. No more aches and pains. Paul sees a time of resurrection and transformation ahead. Like most early Christians, Paul looked forward to Christ's return. Matter of fact, they expected him any day now. That's why Paul says, why are you bothering getting married and planning all that stuff? You're going to be here next week. Instead of planning a wedding, why don't you study the works about God and pray and getting your life right? Well, he was wrong. I don't think people didn't listen to him at that point and got married and had kids. And we wouldn't be here. But what you are going through in life, you have the transformation of the resurrection to look forward to. Paul says, therefore, encourage one another with these words. The entertainment industry end time is something to be dreaded. The biblical beginning time is something to anticipate with joy. It's all in your attitude and your viewpoint. Which is your attitude, your viewpoint? Do you have the attitude of the early Christians or the attitude of the entertainment industry? something we look forward to. Let us pray. Lord, help us to look forward to your return, but also look for you and all that we do so that we feel your presence now in everything that we do. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.